Hi everyone, so I'm Damien Ramel. I'm a researcher in I2MC in Toulouse, and today I will talk to you about optogenetics in cell biology. First, I would like to thank the organizer of this webinar to provide me the opportunity to give you this presentation today. So the presentation will be divided in five parts. And I will just present you a basic principle of optogenetics in the beginning. Then I will move to the presentation of optogenetic tools that you can use in cell biology, and then some examples. And then I will present you briefly the material we need to do such experiment of optogenetics and give you some conclusions. So the optogenetic principle. Optogenetics combine the precision and the power of light with the genetics. Indeed, for a long time ago now in our labs, we use genetics and chemicals to manipulate pathways, and these approaches have very low temporal resolution. Indeed, with genetics, we do long-term modification. And using chemicals, most of the time, we have very acute effect on our signaling pathway. And with optogenetics now, we are able to combine the two aspects of this temporal resolution with the possibility to perform acute stimulation and then to repeat this stimulation a long time. So optogenetics provide us the temporal resolution that has never been achieved before. And the same is true with the spatial resolution. Again, here with genetics or chemical, most of the time we treat a group of cells or tissue. But now with optogenetic and with the focalization of laser, we are able to focalize on one cells in a group of cells. So optogenetics give us the opportunity to manipulate cell signaling at the cellular level, and this is the spatial resolution that has never been achieved with classical approach before. So this optogenetic approach have been applied to a wide variety of subjects in cell biology, ranging from gene expression to GPCR signaling, membrane composition, RTK signaling, and so on. And there is, you will see, I will present you, there is a wide range of tools now to perform optogenetic experiment and to manipulate all these biological events. At the beginning, optogenetics have been developed in neurobiology, where neurobiologists use photosensitive molecules for a long time now, in particular channel rhodopsin, which are sensitive to light, to manipulate the behavior of mice. And there is now a whole bunch of papers showing that by applying on genetic modified mice expressing optogenetic modules, the light directly to the brain, we are able now to manipulate the behavior of these mice. In the context of cell biology and cell development, there is two main strategies that have been used, and I will present you some example later, is the dimerization and the sequestration of active protein. So here I will present you a table where the five main strategies of optogenetic have been synthesized for their use in cell biology. So the first one and the mainly used, and I will present you some example later, is the recruitment of protein to a specific cellular compartment, and this is mainly achieved using Cry2 cell-based system I will present you, but also with the LOVE and the DROMPA domain. Another tool that is quite widely used is the control of transcription using LOVE domains, and also the Cry2 modules is used to activate protein by oligomerization, and the opposite is true, where you can use this Cry2 and another optogenetic tool to inactivate a protein by oligomerization. And finally, and I will show you an example at the end, the LOVE domain mainly, but also the DROMPA domain, could be used to sequester an active protein and Inducing conformational change upon light allowed the researcher to unfold this protein and to liberate an active form of the protein. So here I present you all these optogenetic tools and you can see that they are distributed all along the light spectra. And I will not present you all of this, but I will focus on the main that have been used in cell biology and cell development experiment, which are the Cry2 module with the CIB1 and the love domains. These two proteins are stimulated by UV light around 458 or 488 nanometer of wavelength. So I will start with the Cry2 cyabian system, which are cryptochromes coming from plants. They are implicated in growth control in response to light, but also in the regulation of circadian rhythm. This system is a bimolecular system composed of a protein called CIBN and a protein called Cry2. This Cry2 protein is sensitive to light, so in the blue light. And upon stimulation, there is a conformational change occurring in this Cry2 protein, allowing the increasing the affinity of Cry2 for CIBN quite dramatically. And the interaction, the half-life of this interaction is about 3 to 5 minutes. So to perform an optogenetic experiment, researchers have, for example, targeted the CIBN to a specific compartment to the into the cell and fuse their protein of interest to the Cry2. Then you can tag all of these proteins with fluorescent markers, so GFP and MCHERRY. And now with the development of far red fluorescent protein, you can add another level of complexity and add a reporter tagged with far red fluorescent protein. So here some examples of the use of this Cry2 CIBN system in cell biology. The first one, as I told you, is the recruitment of protein. So here I present you the optogenetic probe for PI3 kinase. And what has been done here by the author is to target the CIBN protein tagged with GFP to the plasma membrane using a CAX motif and fuse the ISH2 from P85 to Cry2 and tag with MCHERRY. This ISH2 domain is able to recruit PI3 kinase and then activate its activity. And in this set of experiments, the author fused the pH domain of AKT, which will reflect the activation of PI3 kinase with the RFP protein. Donc, you are an example of experiment here, where you have the optogenetic probe, it's COS7, which is quite soluble in the cytoplasm at the beginning. And when light is applied, you'll see recruitment to the plasma membrane and membrane deformation induced by the activation of PI3 kinase. And this is the image from the movie here. You see at the beginning, the probe is soluble. Upon light, blue light illumination, the probe is recruited to the plasma membrane and induce deformation. And then when you shut down light and you let recover the cell, the probe returns to the cytoplasm. And here you have the images from the reporter, the pH domain of AKT, showing that upon light stimulation, it is recruited to the plasma membrane. And again, when we recover the cell, this recruitment is lost, meaning that PI3 kinase is not anymore at the plasma membrane. So this is the first example of the use of Cry2 CIBN by inducing the recruitment of active protein to the plasma membrane. But you can use the same system to inhibit protein, and for example, by sequestering far away from the site of activation activators of protein. And this is the strategy that can be used in for the control of the activity of RhoA. So basically what has been done is that the CIBN protein has been anchored to the mitochondria. And on the other side, the Cry2 protein has been fused to the GEF, which is an activator of RhoA, and the MCHERRY. And then when you activate with light, you the author will be able to recruit the Cry2 and the GEF to the mitochondria, so far away of the plasma membrane, where the normal which is the normal site of recruitment of this GEF and the activation of RhoA. So here you have an example, The author have used ERFP vinculin as a reporter, and this is what you see here with focal adhesion here. And the movie starts at the beginning. There is a steady state, and when we activate light, you see the relaxation and the diminution of the fluorescence of vinculin, meaning that there is a decontraction of the cell here, and this is quantified here on this image. And here the quantification of the fluorescence of focal adhesion, we see the decrease of the fluorescence, meaning that rho A have been inactivated at the site of adhesion at the plasma membrane, and then by relaxing the cell, the focal adhesion fluorescence returns to normal. So here we have inactivated the rho A by sequestering its activator at the mitochondria. The same strategy could be used to do exactly the opposite, so the activation this time of rho A. So instead of targeting cyabn to the mitochondria, we target cyabn to the plasma membrane. And here the gap will be addressed to the plasma membrane, and then it will activate the Roway pathways. Here it's experiment done in Drosophila, and the author has used as a reporter the GAP33 protein which tag the membrane, and using mCherry, but they untag the Cry2 gap module. You have the result here, so you have to focus on the rectangle here. This is the site of photoactivations. The cells with the blue circle have been the one which will be activated. And this is the movie. And you see that at the site of activation, there is a constriction of the tissue. So this is the reflex of the activation of rho A at the plasma membrane. And this is quantified here. And we focus on the blue curve here, which is the apical area of activated cells, which is diminished upon after stimulation, meaning that rho A has been activated. Then the Cry2 system has been also applied to induce oligomerization and to trap protein in the cytoplasm. So here it's a system that has been developed, which is called LARIAT, for light activated reversible inhibition by assembled trap. And basically what has been done is to fuse the CIBN module to an oligomerization domain of the calmodulin. And then you, on the other side, you fuse your Cry2 protein with your protein of interest. And when light is applied, the module will interact with CIBN, and you are able to sequester your protein to these modules of CIBN calmodulin. And this is what has been done in this nice movie, where you can see that you are able, upon light illumination, of accumulate to sequester protein in aggregate in the cell. And this is again reversible, since when you remove light, the optogenetic probe returns to normal. And finally, with this Cry2 CIBN system, you can also use another particularity of the system to manipulate biological elements such as traffic and endosomal trafficking. This property is that Cry2 protein are able to dimerize by themselves. And so what has been done is that the CIBN model this time has been used to the protein of interest of RAB GTPases here, that is connected to endosome, tagged with the RFP, and upon elimination there is dimerization of Cry2. And then in your cells, what will happen is that the interaction with CIBN will drive together the RAB protein and thus the endosome. So you are able to sequester at one place endosomes in a cell. And this is what has been done here in COS7 cells, expressing so a construct tagging RAB5 or RAB11 and fused to Cry2 IFP. And you can see here open elimination, accumulation of endosome in a huge aggregate, but it's again reversible by relaxing, letting the cell relaxing after light illumination. So these are the main example of the use of the Cry2 CIBN system, which is quite widely used in cell biology. And another tool which is quite powerful is the LOVE system. So again, so this love system came from plants, where it's implicated in growth control in response to light. And it's at a molecular level, it's a more simpler system, which is a monomeric. It consists in an alpha helix and a beta sheet. Upon light illumination, again in a range of blue UV light, there is a conformational change of this alpha helix, which open the molecule. Thus, what has been done here is to fuse the protein of interest to this construct, and upon illumination, you are able to liberate this protein that could mediate this effect in the cells. You can tag the construct with mCherry again, and again, you can use reporter system using a far-red fluorescent protein. In this case, the half-life of the opening of the molecule is shorter than with the Cry27 system with a half-life of 80 seconds. So what I've been done with this love system, it's the control of drug activity. Indeed, this love system is very suitable for the control of active proteins such as small GTPases. And what I've been done is to fuse the love system with the RAC Q61L protein, which is the active form of RAC. And in the dark, when the conformation is closed, the molecule is trapped and is blocked as an inactive molecule. When you apply light, the opening of the love system liberate the active form of RAC that can play its role on actin dynamics and regulation of migration, for example. And this is what I show you here. It's a movie of border cells expressing this constriction. And you will see that at the beginning, the border cells are very round and they are not able to migrate. And then upon stimulation, here you will see that we are able to drive the migration by activating RAC at the front of this migrating group of cells. And here again, it's reversible at the end if we stop illumination. The activation of RAC will stop. So all these tools of optogenetics I'll present you are mainly available to classical banks as plasmids of lentivirus, so you can transfect or infect your cells. And now also there is a whole bunch of genetically modified animals model which express these optogenetic probes, such as Drosophila, as I show you, but also C. elegans and mouse. So optogenetic is could be applied to a wide range of biological processes and biological model. And to perform an experiment of optogenetic, you don't need a very complicated device because you just need to have UV laser. So for example, 4-5-8 or 4-8-8 laser, which is available of most of the confocal we have in our labs. And so a basic experiment could be done with a classic confocal you have in your lab. Then to perform more complicated optogenetic experiment with particular pattern of illumination or in 3D, there is some company that develop devices that allow the design of optogenetic experiments that are quite more sophisticated. So in conclusion, I will say that there is several advantages to use optogenetics, and the first one, as I told you at the very beginning of the presentation, is that these optogenetic approaches give you a spatial temporal resolution, which is quite important, and also that you have almost total control of your experimental device because you can activate the light when you want, and this is a very big advantage of the optogenetics strategy. Then these optogenetic approaches are applicable to a wide variety of biological systems, and also you can do it on a very a variety of optic devices as soon as you are able to activate and image red fluorescent protein. And finally, this optogenetic approach are very robust and sensitive and give quite reproducible results. However, there is some limitation, and the main one is that you have to use a confocal to activate and to do your imaging, and this could be a problem in particular for very dynamic experiment. So there is some people that develop external laser of to photo activate, meaning that the UV light doesn't come anymore in the confocal head. And it is driven externally to the confocal system that give you the opportunity to be more dynamic in your photo activation experiment. Another problem could be that we don't have much subcellular resolution, and it's mainly due to the laser and to the use of your confocal. And also a problem is that the photo inactivation is not controllable, so you have to activate, and then if you want to do again, you have to wait for the return to the steady state of your optogenetic module. Finally, also it's quite difficult to control over biochemical process than binding or activation, inactivation by conformational changes. So this it could be a problem if your protein is not be sequestered properly by the love protein, for example. And another problem you can encounter when you do experiment is to multiplex multiple wavelengths. Indeed, you have to manage with the wavelength of activation, and you have also the wavelength of acquisition of your protein. So most of the time, when your experiment is very dynamic, it could be a problem to have the wavelength of photoactivation, the wavelength of visualization of your optogenetic module, and an extra fluorescent reporter. And here, the development of infrared protein could be an important tool for the future for optogenetic experiment. Also, most of the time, optogenetic experiments are done by overexpression, but recently it has been also applied with together with CRISPR technology. So and it works. So now this overexpression problem could be overcome by the use of these new editing genome techniques. And finally, but this one is inherent to optogenetic, is that the use of light can be can generate damage to the cells and the tissue, and that could be a problem for your experiment. So I'm done here with this presentation. You can continue to learn about the optogenetic by going to the EMBL e-learning site, which is quite very well done, and there is a section about optogenetics. Thank you for your attention.